Hello everyone, Oves.net here. Hope you are all well. I'm back after a long summer holiday, and this time I have something special. Of course, it's an 8-bit machine, as you probably guessed, and this one I've been looking for a long time for to get my hands on. And I finally found one on from a Norwegian seller I met at a Norwegian retro computer Facebook group. So always good to be in the community. Yeah, and it's a VTech Laser 200 color computer, and it looks absolutely fantastic. And it also got a 16K RAM expansion, and of course the power supply. And the reason this machine is special to me is because this was the first home computer I owned in the beginning of the 80s. I got this machine as a Christmas gift with a cassette recorder. I think it was around 82 or 83. I got it from my parents, and it was ridiculously expensive at that time. I think they paid like 3,000 NOK, which in today's value is about 300 euros. I'll get back to the specification of this machine in a minute, but in the meantime, look at this keyboard. It's rubber keys, and they look all fantastic, not worn at all, except for this shift key maybe. So this was my first computer, and this was the one I learned to program BASIC in. And this is the backside, and it says Laser 200 color computer. Do not remove cover. Video technology. Some of you might have heard about VTech or video technology because they even exist today, but today they produce for the most part toys and like toy computers and stuff like that. The Laser 200 or the VZ200 microcomputer was an 8-bit machine manufactured by Video Technology and released in 1983. But it was also sold under a set of different names, for example the Salora or the Dick Smith VC200. The machine was in fact a development of an earlier TRS-80 copy, and it contains the same BASIC, or almost the same BASIC as the TRS-80. As with other machines at that time, the BASIC was delivered by Microsoft. The CPU was the Zilog Z80 running at 3.58 MHz. This was the same CPU as the Sinclair ZX81 and Spectrum and other machines at that time. Depending on the model, the memory was initially 4 KB of RAM and 16 KB of ROM, but later this was increased to 8 KB of RAM. And depending on the mode, it had a maximum of 8 different colors. The machine is supposed to be working, and I already tested it a couple of months back, but you never know, so I'm gonna connect it to my trusty old LCD TV. The thing is, it has both composite and TV out, so I'm gonna go with the TV modulator out first. I turn the machine on, and now I'm doing a channel search. Looks like the TV found already channel C4, and if you see on the back side here, there's a switch between channel 4 and channel 3. It says no signal. All right, yeah, there it is. And the sound is kind of noisy. It says Video Technology BASIC V2 ready. Excellent. So the picture from the RF output is not the best, and a greenish color. Why on earth did they use that background color? Let me try to write the program here. Alright, okay, I connected the cable to the composite out, let me try that one. This is using the SCART input on the TV. Alright, that looks much better. Maybe it doesn't show that good on the video because I'm filming the screen, but this is a much better quality picture. The machine now has been turned on for about 1 hour and seems to be working fine, so my next step is to open it up and take a peek inside. As you can see, the machine is not yellowed at all, and the plastic seem like a different type of plastic that the ones you are used to with the Commodore machines and other machines that are getting yellow by the time. So how do you open this machine without breaking anything? Alright, lift it straight up, and there is the ribbon cable for the keyboard, so you have to be careful with that. Okay, so the ribbon cable for the keyboard is actually soldered onto the motherboard, so it's not possible to remove it easily, and on this side it's glued. Otherwise everything looks okay. There's a big shield or heatsink here, and everything seems to be soldered together. It's clean and no dust. So everything looks okay, so I'm not gonna do anything drastic about this. So I'm gonna leave the machine as it is for now, and maybe in another video I'll do some future proofing by switching out some capacitors and things like that. But looks very good, so no need to do any cleaning inside. Next thing I want to do is to test if the 16K memory expansion is actually working, but how am I gonna do that? I don't have a single program or a game or anything for this machine. By looking through some manuals online, I found that if you peek into a few system pointers for basic here, you can find the top of the available memory location. So in this case, without the memory expansion, it says the top is at location 32767. Then I insert the memory expansion. So it's not like it's displaying the available memory like the Commodore 64. Now with the memory expansion inserted, I run the same command, and as you can see, the top of the memory is at location 49151. And if you look at the difference between those numbers, 49151 minus 32767. It is exactly 16 kilobyte. So this means that the memory expansion is working. However, it does not mean that every memory chip is working 100%. To evaluate that, you need some memory testing hardware or program. If you are into testing different games for the Laser 200 or the VC200, there's a lot of resources on the internet, a lot of software archives and even emulators. I found one emulator here called WinVC, and it doesn't work very well on Windows 10 at least, but you can load VC files, which are the archives for the games. This one is a simple example. On the vc200.org page, there's a lot of resources and documentation for these old machines. I'll link to this page in the description below. As I mentioned, I don't have a cassette recorder for this machine, so and also I have no tapes or anything to run on it, but I always like to run an actual game or software on the hardware and not the emulator. So the machine has a 3.5 millimeter audio input, so I'm thinking about connecting that to my iPad or phone. So I already downloaded a large archive of games for the Laser 200. And the games are stored in these VC archive files. But how do you get them over to be played as audio? In order to play back an archive file as an audio file, you need some tool, and I found this VC Utils, which contains a program for converting a VC archive file to audio. Here's a sample WAV file that contains a program. And this VC Utils contains a program called CVC2 WAV. So let me try this one, and let me select a VC file. Let me try Circus. I go with the default settings, and immediately after selecting the file, it already created a WAV file in the same folder. When I look at the different settings here, I think it's best to use 44 kilohertz and square, because it says use this if your VC200 is connected to your PC sound card. Alright, so I just copied those files to my OneDrive, and then I'm gonna test playing them back from my Mac to my Laser. I have this mono dual 3.5 millimeter cable, which I'm gonna connect to my Macintosh from its headphone output, and then connected to my Laser in the audio input. Okay, modern computer meets old 8-bit computer. Let me try and load. Then on my Mac, I just start playback one of the files I uploaded. All right, it says loading Circus at first try. Amazing. Okay, loading error. Well, it was the first try, so you can't expect it to work on first try. Actually, it did load a program, so even though it says loading error, so I'll try to run it. I try again, this time with the volume from the Mac onto max. Nope, still didn't work. Let me try one of the other files. So it seems to be loading fine in the beginning, because if you list the program, you see the first lines are correct, but then it's garbled. So at least it played the Star Wars tune, but then it had a syntax error, because further down the program there is errors. Okay, now it's getting somewhere. It actually loaded without error. And what I did, I played back the WAV files with the QuickTime player instead of playing through the browser via OneDrive. So I'm thinking maybe OneDrive does something with the media files, reduces quality or anything like that. But whatever, let me try and run this game here. Okay, auto memory error in 10. Excellent. The whole program seemed to be loaded, but it also contains machine code, which the last statement, A equals USR, is calling a machine code subroutine. Okay, I tried a lot of different games now, converting them to audio wave files and playing them back from a computer, and most of them load fine, but when you try to run, you either crash or get the auto memory exception, or as you can see in this case, it gives auto memory error. And a lot of times a game is loaded. If you list it, it starts to list the basic code, but after a while, the code gets garbled like this. So my conclusion is loading is fine, but there is a memory issue with this machine. All right, I think this is it for this Laser 200 computer. I'm a bit disappointed that I couldn't run any of the games I wanted. So my conclusion is that maybe it has a problem with some of the memory chips. And I'm not gonna try and fix that in this video. That might come in another video sometime later. However, a great machine, a bit of a nostalgia trip for me, since this was my first computer ever. So I'm pretty pleased with having one in my collection. Okay, I hope you enjoyed this video, and hope you will subscribe to my channel. Thanks for watching. Bye bye.